examining the current and future state of telemedicine. We've got three tremendously skilled and experienced technology leaders in telemedicine and cybersecurity. I'm going to make these intros brief so we can get you can just hear what they have to say. Take a trip to LinkedIn if these intros are a little brief and see how their incredible experience and credentials. Our first panelist is Clinton Phillips, who's the CEO and founder of Medici Telemedicine, which is a leader in HIPAA-compliant telehealth solutions. Alongside him is Daniel Kivatinos, who's the COO and co-founder of DrChrono, which makes a medical records platform that processes over $4 billion a year in medical claims for over 23 million patients. Finally, there's my colleague Candid Wuest, who is Acronis' Vice President for Cyber Protection Research. Previously, he served as the tech lead for Symantec's Global Security Response Team for 16 years. He's also an advisor to the Swiss federal government on cyber risks. So let's get to it, gents. I've got a few kind of data points to kick off each one of our questions here. This was a shocking one to me, which the AHA projected that American hospitals lost over $160 billion in just the first 3 months of the pandemic. So shocking business impact that's going to set a lot of providers back a bit. Seems to me, based on what Dr. Kivitar started out saying, that telemedicine is really looks like a transformative technology. But I wonder how much it helps the sort of the upstarts in the business. I think of people like Amazon, Walmart, and how much it might help or hurt traditional healthcare providers. Clint, why don't you start us off there? Give us a couple minutes of your thoughts on that.
Yes, well, for Medici, we've been preaching this to providers, to doctors for a few years now, that the day is coming where there will be more virtual visits every day than there will be in-person visits. And the average doctor had a very hard time getting their arms around that. And that changed almost overnight. We went from seeing the types of, you know, people seeing doctors who are doing one video or telemedicine consult a month, were all of a sudden doing 20 in a day. So it was just a huge transition to be able to see virtual care be brought forward so many years. But it had big impacts, you know, serious impacts for surgeons who were not able to do surgeries. Something like 21% of doctors have either been furloughed, had their reimbursement cut, or are closing their practice. So it's been a very disruptive time for healthcare overall, but for virtual care or telemedicine, it's been a remarkable time to see that, as Dr. Kivitar alluded to, there have to be more delivery models than just going into the office.
Thanks for that, Clint. Daniel, you want to chime in on this?
Sure. The way that I kind of view healthcare is that a lot of it is driven by reimbursement and how the providers are reimbursed. When you look at the GDP of the United States, it's roughly $3 trillion. Let's assume, like, you know, $1.5 trillion is probably Medicare, Medicaid, and their payments. Now, prior to COVID, how easy was it for a provider to get paid from a telemedicine appointment? I don't think it was the acceptance rate of a telemedicine appointment and the amount that they were getting paid was vastly different prior to COVID. So when you look at COVID and what it's done, it kind of forced the medical community immediately to look and say, how do we see as many patients as possible if they have COVID? What if I have COVID? It kind of created this really a pressure point. And the government started paying. Medicare started paying for these reimbursement for these telemedicine appointments. And for me, that was a turning point historically for all of us to see healthcare just change in like a month. We've seen in our platform accelerated growth, thousands and thousands of patients just starting to see providers through telemedicine, and Medicare is paying out and the insurers are paying out. And that kind of changes the complete mindset where a provider can see a patient remotely and do care. Now, you know, I spoke to one provider, they had COVID. he was fine. He was healthy. He wanted to see patients. How do you do that? You can't go to the office. So he started to see patients remotely, right? And vice versa, if you have a patient who has COVID and they just want to do a check-in with a provider, does that provider really want them to come in if they're feeling fine? So I think it immediately transformed the way that we think about healthcare. You know, we're all in this virtual meeting. Have we had these virtual meetings before? The answer is no. Like, these were happening, but not at the rate they're happening now. I see them coming up all over the place, but providers really have changed their mindset. The government has changed their mindset. The insurers have changed their mindset. So it's really an instantaneous change in the world. It's kind of like we forced ourselves to go into the year 2020 very quickly in the medical community, which I'm really, really, it gives me hope that we were able to do that, something that fast.
That's great stuff. Candid, can you throw in a quick comment on the cybersecurity angle?
Yeah, I think it was already some good points made here. Of course, we will need some kind of guidance as well. I mean, it's not that it's new for the hackers, right? The whole telemedicine or even just hospitals, right? There's a lot of private sensitive information, and hackers have been attacking that for the past decade, and they probably will for the next decade as well. So wherever we move into, we have to make sure that it's also secure from the IT perspective.
That's actually an excellent segue into our next topic, which is telemedicine vulnerabilities. The statistic there is 102 days. That's the average time that a known vulnerability lies unpatched in a healthcare technology system, operating system, or application. And that's kind of frightening, you know, for on average 3 months, which means for some it's 4 or 5 months, that they're sitting there with fixes that they know could be applied, but for whatever reason, and it's typically understaffing or fear of breaking production applications with an update that hasn't been tested, but many healthcare organizations are sitting kind of wide open. I wonder if you gentlemen could comment on how telemedicine as an application, as a system that encompasses a much longer delivery chain, in many cases with new at-risk technologies like the Internet of Things, sort of famously unpatchable and not very secure in a lot of cases. 5G is kind of a new wider path that looks like a new attack surface. Where do you think we need to focus on this vulnerability issue when it comes to telemedicine? Daniel, why don't you start? Give us a couple minutes there.
Sure. You know, this one, healthcare in general, the data there is extremely sensitive, and we all want to take as many precautions and take care of, you know, the patient's security. Telemedicine is very new, and we've seen, you know, publicly there were a couple of exposures out there of companies who have accidentally, you know, hackers could get in and get and view conferences and whatnot. How do we protect against that? I think there's got to be a lot of stringent review that happens on the technology layer, that happens at the provider's office. You know, there's so many moving parts now. Prior to all of this, it was kind of simple, right? You could go, like, a lot of the facilities kind of would silo the data. They had their hospital. They put the servers in the basements. They put the machines in the hospital. They had no access outside. We're kind of in a new world now where telemedicine is kind of opening us all up. So there's a lot more variable. And as a developer of telemedicine, DrChrono develops telemedicine, we have to really be aware of what device, how the providers are using it, how the patients are using it. You know, it's kind of a whole new world. And you bring in IoT, that's another interesting topic here, where there are a lot of new devices out there. You know, I'll give you one example. There's glucometers, there are scales, there are blood pressure cuffs, there are all these different devices out there connecting to, you know, to the internet, And if providers are doing telemedicine appointments real time, what does it look like with this, I'd call it, heterogeneous world of devices? It's going to be a very different world, but I would say the security, it has to be paramount here. And the answer is it's, you know, there's always hackers out there looking to get into to these complex systems. It's just, we're going to have to really be very stringent in the way that we're all looking at these systems communicating together. So it's a really complex problem, and it's never going to go away. There's never going to be like a perfect fix.
Yeah, I've disabled the Bluetooth on my smart scale. I don't really want any of that information getting out. Candid, I imagine you have a lot of done some deep thinking on this particular subject.
Yeah, I think Danny made a fair point. Security has to be kind of an overall thought, right? Kind of taking care of all the different aspects. And of course, yeah, protecting the privacy and having strong authentication is, of course, or hopefully should be on top of your priority list here for any medical application. So to making sure that only those who need to have access will have access to the data, multi-factor authentication, segmentation of data, all those things can be applied. But of course, in general, all medical devices need to be secured, right? From the insulin pump that you wear on or in your body down to any medical device in the hospital, as they're per se just small computers which can and are being attacked, right? And to give you one example, last April, some researchers in Israel found some vulnerabilities in medical devices and created a proof of concept malware which was able to change and add fake kind of cancer images to MRI and CAT scans. But they were also able to remove real cancer or cancerous nodes from those images before it was passed to the actual doctor for the review. And you can imagine that definitely leads to some serious misdiagnosis, right? So just imagine if that would have happened on a service for a telemedical application where all the pictures are passed through or stored. That would be definitely catastrophic. And on top of that, you also have to take care of phishing attacks, because that will definitely happen. Or even just denial of service attack where someone will bring your service down, which probably is not good for your kind of overall business as well. So lots of things to take care of. It is possible, but it has to be thought of.
I think I saw that smart insulin pump attack on an early season of Homeland. Just horrific. Clint, do you want to make a brief comment here?
Yes, we've been very surprised by the lack of desire for security and compliance just in this COVID wave. We spent a ton of time getting every certification and thinking around security, whereas most telemedicine actually moved towards things like Zoom or Doxy or video, things that don't require authentication of the provider, they didn't require authentication of the patient. And so it's been really felt like the Wild West, where people have said, give me the easiest possible thing, and I'm willing to take the risks on this not actually being, you know, compliant or secure. So when you start to add IoT into it, it starts to really feel like the Wild West of who's watching. And I think it's going to take some pretty catastrophic breaches for people to get very serious about, wait a minute, this is this telehealth is exposing me in new ways as a patient or as a physician that I haven't actually really had to think about when, as Daniel said, the servers were in my basement, the files were locked away in my office. And now there's, you know, we're having hundreds of thousands of conversations a month virtually that, you know, people can listen into, people can try and retrieve post consult. It's just it's a very new world, and it takes some very fresh thinking as to how we're going to be able to protect these sensitive conversations.
Yeah, I really truly hope that medical IoT devices are more secure than my Nest smart doorbell or light bulbs at home. Those are not secure. All right, I wanted to move along. Question number three is about patient privacy. breaches are something I talk about all the time to audiences of Acronis prospects and partners when I'm talking about cybersecurity. My old stat here was that something like 6 billion confidential records were breached in all of 2019. And then I came across this stat that said 8 billion were, nearly 9 billion were breached last month alone. And that's obviously a gigantic issue in healthcare, whether it's sensitive patient data, which is, you know, sensitive, subject to compliance issues, intellectual property, or credentials that healthcare technologists use to control systems. Obviously, the breaches of those, the potential wreak all kinds of havoc. I'd like to ask each of you in turn to talk a little bit about how this issue affects telemedicine. It certainly seems more, in some respects, it might be more vulnerable to it. Again, that long supply chain. There's also this issue of patients need access to their medical information and cost information about it, but the providers have this imperative to protect it for compliance purposes. And so maybe you could comment both about vulnerabilities to breaches and what it means of that kind of privacy versus transparency conundrum. Clint, why don't you start?
It is a conundrum, I think, is the right word. Today, telemedicine companies, I think healthcare systems, have to choose very carefully between how do we create the right level of security and privacy, but how do we also make this easy, you know, to be able to drive some types of utilization? Patients are looking for ways that they can easily access their medical care, their medical records. At the same time, you know, they are trusting that the systems that hold these are taking incredibly good care of these. So I think patient privacy is, you know, is being redefined right now. In as we look at somebody receiving a text with a link to a video, how certain do we want to make sure that that text, that phone number is actually the patient? Do we want that to be pre-verified? And does that person have to sign up an account before and agree to all sorts of terms of services? As there's such a huge push for there to be interoperability between platforms like DrChrono and all the different hundreds of EHRs that there are in place now, as we're looking for interoperability, with that desperate need for interoperability becomes significant opportunities for private data to be stolen, breached, lost, exposed, and we have to think incredibly carefully through each one of those steps because we want our patients to have their data, we want patients to be able to access care. But what risks are we willing to put in place to make that easy?
Daniel, you want to chime in with a brief comment on this?
Sure. You know, there's an emotional barrier. It's like when banking first went online, right? People were like, I don't want to put my money in the internet. that's crazy. And you know, they would hold the physical cash. And I think the mindset shifted over time pretty quickly because people realize the ease and the benefit of it. You know, there are risks. There are risks with exposing private data, right? Say a provider records a session and somehow that session is exposed. You know, that's a new risk out there. Before, sessions weren't being recorded, right? People would go into the doctor's office, the doctor would see you, it'd be a completely private experience. But now that there's microphones and there's video cameras and you can record these sessions, you know, it's a whole new level of exposure that we all kind of take on as you know, as the world, honestly. And it's, do you want to take that risk? It's convenience, you know, versus risk. So I don't really have a good answer here, but I think, you know, the mindset is like, if, you know, I'll give you one example, psychiatry or psychology. I see that as a great area for telehealth, because there's a lot of stigma around going to a psychiatrist, psychologist, but it's kind of easy just to turn on the camera, you know, start talking to them, but you're also exposing yourself to all of those possible privacy risks because now the data is in the cloud and they're entering data in the cloud and there's this video in the cloud. So it's cost versus reward, and we have to secure it.
Some Zoom sessions are more sensitive than others. Candid, I know you spent a lot of time thinking about this issue for many years before you even got to Acronis. Some brief thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely all about the trust, right? It has to be convenient, but the patient has to trust that their data is safe. And as both of my panelists said, hey, if it happens, it's definitely not good. And unfortunately, we have seen cases like this. For example, last week, there's a UK e-health smartphone application which accidentally actually sent the recording of the consultation
to a handful
of other people, which is exactly not what you want to have, because that means those patients probably will change, right? Go to another doctor or at least use another application. And it's everywhere, right? Seen last year, some friends of mine, they looked at 5 different e-health apps in Germany, and they found vulnerabilities in all of them, from simple SQL injections revealing the whole database down to 2 short encryption keys which were able to brute force and then still get access to the data. But it is a difficult balance. It has to be convenient, right? I mean, nobody really wants to sign up first with a blood test somewhere just to be able to then access it through, I don't know, some IoT device that every time takes a drop of your blood. But the technology is there to make it secure. It's just very often that it's badly or wrong implemented or not really followed through. And as Clinton said, it seems to be that a lot of the patients, as in clients, do not really ask for security at the moment, which of course means why should you care to get all the certifications if you can just use any Zoom or other video conferencing and the people will still come, right? So there has to be some regulations and kind of some requirements as well.
Short encryption keys in 2020. Tisk, tisk. All right. I want to move along briskly here so we don't fall too far behind schedule here. I'm sure as technology leaders, you've all got opinions on the subject of emerging technology in healthcare tech. The stat here is that spending on AI in healthcare is going to grow fairly significantly year over year for the next 5-6 years. So what I'd like to each comment about is how emerging tech I use examples like AI and blockchain because there's some cool tech that Acronis uses, but obviously there are some other things going on in telemedicine that would fall under this rubric. How do you think they're going, this newer tech is going to affect telemedicine, and by extension, what does it mean for the healthcare business and its health in general? Candid, why don't you start out first this time?
Yeah, I think artificial intelligence will definitely help us go through all that vast amount of information which is now available, right? And we probably would not be able to go through it and find correlations just by hand. Finding out the kind of tone in your voice could reveal if you have some specific disease or just a normal cough from a flu. That's, of course, something which will kind of help very early to prevent some of the diseases, right? And there's a lot of information out there. Just think about all those quantified self apps like fitness tracers, sleep monitors, heart monitors on the watch or on your phone. There's a lot of information there which could potentially be used. And I think that could definitely revolutionize the whole early diagnostics, specifically if you combine it with 5G and, let's say, cheap sensors, as in not so expensive sensors being available. So you can actually make your smart sneaker, which will report back some information, or your, I don't know, shirt, which will also gather some information about your skin and can transfer that back to the doctor. Of course, you have to be assured that you're only sending it to the person that you want to send it to, and also to make sure that the data is then used correctly and not kind of misused for marketing or something else.
That's great. Daniel, how about you?
Yeah, I think one thing that AI is kind of interesting in telehealth, specifically in telemedicine, as you're having that dialogue, the patient and the doctor, there's a lot of information exchange that is happening. And one of the things, you know, I see in the industry today is there's a lot of scribes. They hire a scribe, and that's someone that generally sits in the room with the provider and furiously types on a keyboard or on, you know, taps on an iPad while the patient is talking, while the provider is seeing that patient. One of the things I'd love to see, and this is, you know, that I think that we're going to get to this point, is there may be like a co-pilot AI that sits there and kind of recommends scribe, you know, it says, here's what I've heard and here's what I present. So that's kind of one thing that I think AI will be really interesting around. One other thing about AI, I think visually with telehealth, say you have a patient and AI might catch, you know, facial movements indicating, say, depression or anxiety, and the provider may be able to see that and go, okay, this is, I didn't catch that. So there's a lot around AI that I'm really, you know, it's going to be fun to see where the world is at in 10 years with all the companies investing heavily in AI.
Natural language processing enhanced by AI. That makes a lot of sense. Clint, thoughts here? You don't have to limit yourself to AI as a technology. I know that's a favorite here.
Yes, AI is probably the most exciting of these because of the impact, especially when you pair it with telemedicine. The fact that a doctor, we're running a program now where the AI asks the patient 7 to 10 questions and then prepares a clinical summary for the doctor and quickly highlights a doctor can jump straight into know, here's what's already been identified. When you talk about AI on MRIs and diagnostics, we see the position of the doctor moving from being the diagnostician to really being the coach in helping drive behavior change with that. Blockchain, I've attended a few conferences. I still battle to see its implication, but I know people are over the moon and think that what blockchain will be able to do for medical records and pieces is exciting. We stick to what we know, and anything that can make a virtual encounter or telemedicine better, we are very passionate about. And AI, blockchain, IoT, any of these things fit together to give a doctor better information. Our goal is that a doctor sitting on the beach on our application will have better information than if that patient was sitting across the table from them in their office. So we are looking for ways all the time to make that doctor more effective, more efficient, and utilizing any tools that can provide that physician with better information to make less mistakes, provide high quality of care. We are watching very closely.
So AI-enabled robotic process automation as an assistant, really, really interesting. All right, we have a whole next panel on innovation in tech, so I want to move on. Question 5 is one that's near and dear to my heart. I've been talking to Acronis audiences for 3 years now about the ransomware threat, and of course, it particularly loves healthcare. You know, when healthcare systems are down, lives are at risk, so they're more likely to pay the ransom. And you would think that, yeah, even after the big growth that this stat illustrates in the fourth quarter that they might have eased off during the pandemic, actually they doubled down on healthcare. And so the reasonable assumption here is that telemedicine gets more widespread, it too will become a target for ransomware cyber gangsters. What do you think about that, and what steps can our audience take to include defenses against that in their plans? Clint, why don't you start here?
Yes, I think the risk of ransomware increases significantly as we have more and more data. As Daniel alluded to, the amount of financial processing or the amount of patients. So as this data we have increases, I think the target on our companies increase significantly. And we've seen hospitals be brought to their knees and have to pay the ransomware because they had no other option. So I think it is a significant risk.
Daniel, any thoughts?
No, I 100% agree with Clint here. You know, telemedicine, I do think that there's a, you know, a picture speaks a thousand words, a video, you know, if doctors are recording these videos, which rightfully so, it can protect them, right? For insurance purposes, they may record the videos, but that is really sensitive data. And we need to make sure that we're basically just securing every possible scrap of data that the provider has, you know, that they're using in their telehealth solution. So it's definitely a target.
Candid, I know you share my abiding interest in this subject. Your thoughts?
Yeah, the passion on ransomware. I definitely agree. I mean, medicine or telemedicine will definitely be in the focus as well, the kind of more it will be used. But I also agree with Daniel that it probably will be more about the data, as in kind of stealing the data, which goes hand in hand with today's ransomware, right? It's not just about encrypting the data. They will exfiltrate the data and then blackmail you, because if you don't pay, they will release the information. And currently, that's usually some kind of financial records of some companies. But just imagine if it would be some test results from a, let's say, HIV clinic, right? Some people probably, I mean, depending on the result, would pay for those results not to be published. And actually, something like this already happened. We've seen a ransomware case in the US where a beauty clinic was attacked and they stole data. They also encrypted it. But then they found out, hey, we can actually go after the patients directly and ask them for money as well, because otherwise we're going to reveal whatever operations they had. So things like this will unfortunately come towards us. So we have to be prepared and make sure that we are secured and the data is secured.
The double extortion attack, steal the info first, lock it up, and then threaten a breach at diabolical. All right, we're running a couple minutes behind here, but I didn't want to let you guys go without giving you a chance to give our audience some practical, actionable advice. I've kind of boiled it down into the kind of fortune cookie maxims here, so I would like you to expand a little bit on your tips. Clint, why don't we start with yours? Be prepared to educate patients when asked about privacy and security.
Yes, I think providers are not very aware of how their information is being protected, or what a clinic or a hospital is doing about patients' privacy and security. People love to just say, we're HIPAA compliant, and they just throw that out there, not knowing what's the actual standard or whether they really are. So I think it's important for providers to be able to be educated beyond just delivering care, because part of care is protection of a person's medical information. So hopefully it's quite self-explanatory after that.
That's terrific. Daniel, your tip was, in modernizing your practice for telemedicine, don't overlook remote patient monitoring and healthcare IoT options. Could you give us a little bit more color on that statement?
Yeah, I think we really focused on the telemedicine portion of this, but there's a whole nother, I'd say, complementary component called RPM, or remote patient monitoring, where if a provider can ship out a number of IoT devices, they can monitor that patient remotely without even having a telehealth session. Say they get a scale, say they get a, you know, blood pressure cuff. The doctor's team can remotely monitor that. And if they see any oddities in the, you know, the data that's flowing in, they could set up that telehealth session and have that video conference. So it's, RPM is one of those things I see it's really going to help push the telemedicine world forward.
Thank you for that. Candid, your tip was, craft your digital strategy before you start implementing the tech. Start small, working from clear use cases. Tell us more about that recommendation.
Yeah, I think, as we mentioned, it is now the time that you can actually embrace this opportunity and, right, go forward with it. But you have to have a strategy. So make sure that you're not just blindly buying some IoT devices and kind of trying somewhere. Have a clear use case, what you try to solve, how you want to solve it, and make sure that right from the start, you're involving security people, and at the end that you do some penetration testing. So let someone else try to hack into the application, because that way you can at least have some minimal security standards and not just going to be, owned the next day.
Thanks for that. Gentlemen, thank you all so much for your insight and advice and recommendations here. I let it go on a little longer than we had scheduled because I found too much gold in there. But we're going to move along to our next panel and say thank you so very much. I'd like our next panel to please join the conference, turn your mics and your cameras on. And we are going to go to our last roundtable, which is focused on innovations in healthcare tech as we get to the other side of the pandemic.